Today, I'm in a county that boasts one of the oldest British breeds of sheep that owes its popularity to monks and royalty and has a fleece so valuable it was once referred to as ore. Where am I? Find out in just a moment. Today's quest to help a couple find some countryside calm is one met with some very encouraging feedback.
Wow.
Oh, I love a wow.
Well, you got a wow.
And it's not long before we uncover a potential home where things become overwhelming.
All right.
Yeah, I'm fine, but it's just so lovely. It's really just what we're looking for, really, isn't it?
It is.
Today, I'm in Herefordshire, and these are Ryland sheep. The earliest records show that the monks of Leinster developed the breed more than 800 years ago, making them one of the earliest breeds recorded in England. Leinster became the main wool market, and their fleeces were so valuable they were referred to as Leinster ore. The popularity of the breed increased in the 16th century when it was said that Queen Elizabeth I was gifted a pair of socks made from Ryland wool. She liked them so much that she said she would only wear clothes made from the wool in the future. But sheep like these aren't the only thing that's highly prized here in Herefordshire. Let's see more of what this beautiful county has to offer. Nestled up against Wales, landlocked Herefordshire shares borders with the Welsh counties of Powys and Monmouthshire, as well as three other English counties. A deeply rural and sparsely populated region, Herefordshire has a long history of farming and food production, is home to over 3,000 orchards and 5,000 farms. Scatterings of native Hereford cattle also help to mould the landscape and are believed to be one of the UK's oldest pedigree beef breeds. The county's only city is Hereford, whose foundations were laid by the Saxons in the 7th century AD on the banks of the River Wye, England's fifth longest river. And just a stone's throw from the water is the 11th century cathedral, an ancient site of worship that's also home to the Mappa Mundi, the largest medieval map of the world. When it comes to other architectural gems, highlights also include a significant number of striking monochrome timbered buildings with black painted beams and panels of white plaster. A particularly notable example can be found in the market town of Ledbury, whose centrepiece is a 17th century Grade 1 listed market house that sits suspended on 16 oak stilts. So, with a fascinating supply of properties that echo with history, set against a striking backdrop of lush grazing land, there's every reason to choose Herefordshire as a perfect place to get away from it all. Herefordshire offers country living at a and find out. It's a three-bedroom bungalow in a suburban cul-de-sac just on the outskirts of the coastal city of Brighton that our couple Ian and Les currently call home.
We met 7.5 years ago.
We met through mutual friends and we've been living together for 5 years.
Yes.
And we've been civil partners for 3.
Ian is a nursing assistant at a local hospice and Les is involved in the finance sector for a leisure company. But both parties feel their lives are dominated by work, so they want to semi-retire, cut back their working hours and reduce the travelling.
My commute is excruciating. I mean, on an ideal day, I could do it maybe within an hour, but on an average day, it's nearer 2.
I want to do something completely different, not quite sure what yet. We may do something together, may do something separately, we're not quite sure, so the world's our oyster.
And we think moving to the country will just be a nice, simpler lifestyle. Less frenetic, I would say, probably.
And top of the list for that more straightforward way of life is a joint property purchase.
I think we're very excited about buying a house together the first time. Well, we're looking forward to it, aren't we?
I think it's going to be easy because we've got very similar tastes. We kind of know pretty comprehensively what we're looking for and probably more importantly, what we don't like.
Yeah, I think we're both singing from the same hymn sheet, as they say.
So they put their 1950s bungalow on the market and have plans in place to head inland to find...
properties, lovely little villages, little towns, very relaxed. It just seems, you know, ideal for me.
Yes.
And with their newfound freedom, they're both looking forward to focusing more on their hobbies, both at home and out in the open air.
We are looking and joining a rock choir. Ian's very much into his amateur dramatics, so he's going to be looking to do more of that. I love cooking, so I want to expand on that. And that'll also involve growing a lot of food as well, which everyone says they do, I know, but we will.
We certainly love walking, and we feel we've exhausted this area now. That's one of another reason why we want to move, because we can explore new areas and there's plenty of walking opportunities where we're planning to move to.
With a fresh rural location, a change of pace, and hopefully their first home found together, the couple are wholeheartedly embracing this next chapter in their lives.
It's a very exciting adventure. I think sometimes as people approach retirement, they don't necessarily plan it, but we've got the opportunity to plan a whole new beginning, and that, to me, is very exciting.
Ian and Les are very open-minded about location and would even consider crossing the border. So to find their perfect property, we'll be focusing our house search in the western portion of the county near Wales. I'm catching up with the buyers to discover a little bit more about the details of their move. So welcome to Herefordshire.
Thank you.
Thank you.
When you envisage in your mind's eye the home that you're going to live in here, what does it look like?
Somewhere detached, with 2 to 3 bedrooms, study, a big kitchen diner, half an acre of garden.
Okay, half an acre is quite a hefty garden size. I'm guessing that one of you has got green fingers.
Yeah, we both enjoy gardening, actually, yeah.
Yeah, we've got quite a big garden where we are at the moment, so we're quite happy to kind of develop that. So
I wanted to perhaps grow a bit of our own veg as well, that sort of thing. Fruit trees, if there's some, that'd be lovely too.
Mm. Well, we're in the right county for fruit trees.
Yes,
we are. That's
absolutely.
For sure.
We are.
Yeah. So what's the budget that we're working with?
300,000.
That's it.
Well, it's a good budget for Herefordshire, and we've got some fantastic properties to show you. So are you excited, ready to get going?
Absolutely.
Very excited, yeah, yes. Yeah. Really looking forward to this.
Let's get started.
Okay. Good.
For a top budget of £300,000, Les and Ian are looking for a detached home that has 2 to 3 bedrooms, the potential for a study and a large kitchen diner. Then outside, they're after half an acre of grounds to fulfil their ambitions of gardening and self-sufficiency. We have a variety of wonderful homes lined up, but I'll keep our buyers guessing as to the price of each one until the end of the tour. And to finish off our property hunt, we'll be presenting the Mystery House, where they may have to scale back their grand garden plans outside, but which promises grandiose character inside. For the first property on our tour, we're driving up to the north of the county and heading for the quiet hamlet of Ivington Green, just a 10-minute drive from Leinster. Known as the town in the marches, the black and white timbered market town of Leinster has a fine selection of facilities, both essential and luxury, including a butcher's, a grocer's, cafes and boutiques. So Ian and Les wouldn't be too far from civilization, but far enough to really escape the hustle and bustle and find some serious peace and tranquility back in Ivington Green. And it's here that we find our first house, with a lovely outlook across agricultural fields and walking trails right on the doorstep.
So this is our property.
Oh.
Oh.
Very nice.
Yeah. Sits quite nicely. Nice location.
It is, yeah, it's beautiful views.
Fantastic views. Yeah. So it's quiet, but not too far away from anywhere. So, no, I think it looks really good. Nice extension.
Yeah, what about the style of the property? What do you think of that?
I'm not too enamoured on conservatories, to be perfectly honest. But, you know, we'll wait till we get in and see it.
Of course, yeah.
Let's take a look.
OK.
Looking forward to this.
Originally a two-up, two-down Victorian cottage, this detached home is a much evolved property that still retains its traditional charm. It was considerably extended in the late 1980s with a further addition of a conservatory just 4 years ago. Our first stop inside is the main reception room.
So, we come through the little porch and straight into this cosy, snug living room. You can see the original Victorian fireplace, and it's got the old bread oven in the corner.
Oh, wow.
It's lovely. Yeah, that is lovely. It's a real feature of the room, isn't it? It's quite small.
Would this be your main living room?
This is the main living area, yeah.
Right. OK. It's a bit on the snug side.
Let's go through, because I think the kitchen is a really good size. So let's wander through and take a look at that.
Yes.
OK. Follow me through here into the modern part of the house.
Oh, so this is a nice space.
Yeah, this is the extension that was added on in the 80s.
Right.
This is a big room.
Yes.
This is good. Yeah, I like this. Right.
You've got a utility room just off it there with a back door that leads out into the garden.
Oh,
so you've got use that as a boot room, washing machines, everything in there. Keep it all out of sight, which is good.
Yes.
What about the space and the style of this room?
Yes, I love the kitchen units. I think they're really, really nice.
No, I like this. I like this room a lot.
Let's just wander through to the conservatory, because I've got an idea to run by you both.
Okay.
Amazing views.
Yes.
Oh, wow.
You could turn this into something more substantial.
Right.
So you could effectively turn this into an extension that could become your main living area. And I think it really could give you the opportunity to put your stamp on it.
Yes, yes.
I think it would, or maybe something maybe slightly bigger. But it's certainly an improvement on the other room, I would say.
That completes all there is to see on the ground floor of this cottage. And although open to the possibility of a project, it seems that space is a real issue. But upstairs, there are the three bedrooms they requested, all of which are served by a four-piece family bathroom. A double bedroom, presented as a single, has an exposed brick feature wall. The smallest room upstairs is being used as a study. And that just leaves the final dual aspect bedroom.
And into the master bedroom, the largest of the three.
Right.
Again, in the new part of the house.
And fitted wardrobes, I noticed.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's always handy.
Useful.
It's not a big room, but it's big enough for our purposes.
It is, yeah.
It's fine. It's just not grabbing me completely yet.
OK, well, I know the outside, the garden, the views matter to you, and that's definitely a very strong point about this house. So should we go and explore outside?
Yep. Absolutely.
Thanks.
Fortunately, the home really opens up when it comes to the grounds outside, and so should provide Ian and Les with plenty of options for growing fruit and veg. Spread over about a quarter of an acre, the garden has been zoned and partitioned with low box hedging and shrubs. There's also paved seating areas.
And then, of course, there's the pizza oven that the current owner built, which is fantastic.
Unusual, isn't it?
Are you pizza fans, the pair of you?
Yeah, very much so, yes.
we will be more now.
So the garden, is it the kind of size you had in mind?
For me, yes, it is. Yeah, I think it's really manageable. I would definitely redesign parts of it. But yeah, I think this is great. This is just the sort of size I was kind of thinking of, really.
Mm. Yeah, I agree with that, really. It's not too big, not overwhelming.
So what do you think this house is on the market for? Who would like to go first?
I'll go first.
OK.
I would say about 275.
And Ian?
I think I'll go a little lower, I think. 265, I'm going to say.
OK. Well, Ian, Les, you're both wrong, I'm afraid.
Oh. How unusual.
It's under budget.
Oh.
And it's under budget quite substantially. It's on the market for £250,000.
Is it?
Really?
It is.
Oh, right.
Gosh.
Oh, that's a surprise.
It's certainly something to think about, I think.
Yeah,
yes.
Definitely.
Well, why don't you go back inside, take another look around. Now you've got the price in mind, see where perhaps you might spend what you'd have left in the budget.
Right. Yeah.
And come and find me when you're ready.
OK.
OK.
Thank you very much.
Under budget by £50,000, our first property is a character cottage with three bedrooms, a kitchen, breakfast room, a conservatory, and a large established garden. The house is set in a peaceful location, neighbouring farmland at the edge of a pretty hamlet.
I certainly think we would have to spend a bit of time thinking about the house, whether it would be the right one for us. I'm really glad we've seen it. Obviously, the views are fabulous.
I feel this house might not be for us. I think it's a bit on the small side. I mean, everything else is fine, location, everything else is good. I just think it's a bit too small for us.
Time, gentlemen, please. Come on now.
Hello.
Soon enough?
Yes, thank you. It's been good.
And thoughts?
Yeah, I think it's definitely food for thought.
Yeah, definitely.
We'll give it some more.
Yeah, a little bit more time to think about it.
Food for thought's good, because we've got more to see.
OK.
Come on.
Lovely.
When they make their move to Herefordshire, Les and Ian want to make the most of their new surroundings, exploring the great outdoors. Which is something that Paul Morton embraced when he and his wife bought 38 acres of woodland in the village of Ullingswick 6 years ago. They try to live a low-impact lifestyle within the woods and also use the land to make a living. We arrange for our buyers to visit their coppice woodland to find out more.
What is coppicing and how did you get into it?
Well, coppicing simply is to cut a tree down and allow it to grow. Once we've cut them, a coppice worker will then add value to that produce by turning it into various products like bean rods, pea sticks, hurdles.
This time of year is also perfect for harvesting kindling, and Paul usually starts coppicing, which provides him with his raw material, from October through to the end of February. The side branches are trimmed away using an edge tool called a billock.
This will make a nice hedge stake.
And after the lengths for the principal products have been selected, the smaller excess branches and shoots are then collected. These are then seasoned for the best part of a year before being turned into handmade bundles of kindling called pimps. And the pimp making is done in Paul's timber-framed workshop.
And what's the wood? This wood that you've put on the base?
Well, that's what you put in first with the string. So the string goes in first, and then these bits of hazel are slightly larger pieces of wood, and that'll just help the fire get going.
All right.
Okay.
It takes 25 small bundles to make a pimp, so Ian and Les have got a lot of chopping and prepping to do.
That's it.
Pimps were traditionally transported to London during the Victorian era, and it's thought that the name came from the essential role that kindling plays as a kind of agent between the coal and the fire.
Ease it down.
It typically takes Paul about an hour to make 25 bundles, so Paul and Les need to pick up the pace. Once the last one has been tied...
That's it.
The next step is to fasten all 25 together with string to create a complete pimp.
That's your finished bundle.
Wow.
And how many fires could this light, this bundle?
Well, there's 25 bundles within that. Each one can be broken up. You can get two out of each, so there's 50, 60, 70 fires easily,
right.
Really.
That should be enough kindling to keep our couple going through the winter. But with the amount of fireplaces on offer in our next property, they might need to head back here for another pimp before the season is over. We're on the road, travelling down to the south of the county, to the small village of Puntrilas. Local amenities include a post office and a 400-year-old pub, and neighbouring properties include a Grade 1 listed private estate at Kenchurch Court, a stately home situated in 5,000 acres of prime Herefordshire countryside. Now, Ian and Les were both concerned about the apparent lack of space in our first house, so we've really upped the ante and are giving them an extra 700 square feet of property with this one.
So this is a property I wanted to show you.
Oh, it looks big.
Substantial.
It is big, and that's one of the reasons I wanted to show it to you, because I know you've got a lot of friends, they'll be coming to stay with you, you'll be entertaining, and it gives you the space to be able to do that.
Yeah, it's exciting. Very interesting. It's it's very attractive.
It's an Edwardian property, built turn of the 19th century. And it's got a lot of character going on inside. So I think we should head straight inside, because my only worry really about this property is it going to be too big for you?
Right, okay. Good.
First impressions are extremely encouraging, and they'll be even more excited to learn that this property has not one, but three reception rooms. Through a porch is a large entrance hall, off which there are the two front reception rooms, one a more snug sitting room, and on the other side a dining room. Then the main living room lies at the back, with patio doors onto the garden.
You may have two good-sized rooms at the front, but you've also got them.
Wow.
Yes.
Here.
Didn't expect
this
that.
This is very nice, isn't it?
That's fantastic. That's such a surprise.
It is.
Didn't expect that. That fireplace is amazing.
Lovely.
That's really good. Lovely.
So this is your big living room. You've also got a cosy sitting room there at the front. And a dining space as well down here, a good-sized dining room.
Yeah.
Yes.
So how does that feel for rooms?
Well, that's a lot more than we expected. And a lot more, you would think, from looking at the house as well. Well, I didn't expect to see find this at the back, so this is a real bonus. And it's a big room.
The final room down here is the kitchen breakfast room that lies just next door.
Oh. Wow.
Oh, I love a wow.
Well, you got a wow. My God, it's huge.
It is. Again, you've got original cupboards over there, you've got a range, and it's
range,
a real country kitchen with room for a table.
It's fantastic.
We can sit and eat in here and entertain in the other dining room, the formal dining room.
There's plenty of space. God, there's plenty of space for everything, isn't there?
There is.
This is great.
Love the original cupboards.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
Just behind us there, you've got a utility room and also a downstairs bathroom, which is handy.
Perfect.
Yes, very nice.
And it
very
all flows just really well, doesn't it? I love the style of it. This is very much the stuff we like, isn't it? Victorian, Edwardian, that type of thing, you know.
You're smiling.
I am.
And you're smiling.
I'm smiling.
That's
great. Two smiles.
A joint seal of approval for the ground floor, and there's more to keep those smiles on their faces as we head upstairs. There are four bedrooms on offer, one more than they asked for, and they all make use of a contemporary family bathroom. Each of the bedrooms is a good-sized double, and everyone comes with an original feature fireplace. A pale blue room is presented with a single bed, while another is made up as a home office.
And this is the master bedroom.
Ooh. Very nice.
Oh, wow.
Another wow!
Yes, and another fireplace.
Yeah.
Lovely.
Again, typical of the era, aren't they? Very big rooms, nicely proportioned rooms.
Yeah, I'm very excited about it, really. Mm.
Very impressive.
Very impressive indeed.
Yeah. Very big.
Yeah.
But you know, guys, you might not want this to be the master bedroom, and you definitely have options in this house. Just follow me. Because this one is definitely big enough to have been.
Oh, yes, this is a nice room.
OK?
Yeah, it's big enough.
Double aspect as well.
Yes, definitely.
Although the large internal footprint gives great options within the walls, the possibilities are more limited outside. And when it comes to the plot size, well, it's not so spacious. Set just off the road, there's no front garden to speak of. But at the back, there's a secluded gravelled area with enough room for a table and chairs, as well as an ornamental pond.
So, guys, this is what you get.
The garden is small, isn't it?
But, it is. But I think you can do things with it.
Yeah, there's potential.
I think there's things you could change to make it a more sort of cottagey style garden. So I don't think it's a deal breaker.
So potentially this would be okay?
Yes, because we do realise you've got to compromise somewhere, and we're happy to do that.
Yeah.
So let's guess the price, my favourite bit. Who wants to go first this time?
Ian, do you want to go first this time?
OK, I'll go first this time. Well, it's a beautiful house, so I think it's going to be near the top of our budget. So I'm going to say £295,000.
So just under your £300,000 budget. Les?
I think it's even closer.
Do you?
Yeah, I do. So I'm going to say £299,950.
£299,950, OK. Yeah. It's on the market for £240,000.
Really?
Really.
What?
I love that reaction.
240.
We can tell the vendor to put it on for a bit more.
No,
you
no,
lie.
No,
you're
fine.
You sure?
You're fine.
Now, with that in mind, go back in, take a look around, take your time, and I'll come and find you. I think you might be some time.
Thank you, Jenny.
I think we will.
See you later.
Brilliant.
Hugely under budget by some £60,000, this traditional Edwardian property comes with four bedrooms, three reception rooms and a large kitchen breakfast room. It's absolutely chock full of period features and has a compact gravelled garden.
This house is very much my sort of taste, really. Large rooms, a lot of original features, high ceilings, lots of space, and the fireplaces in every room is an absolute bonus. I love that. It really gives it character.
I really like this house. I think it'd be a great house. I can see us living in it quite comfortably.
You took your time.
Well, no surprise, it's so huge. Lots to see.
There's a lot to see there, and we've still got more to see, so come on.
OK. Lovely.
It's the second day of our property search, and with semi-retirement on the cards, our buyers Ian and Les have a £300,000 budget to spend on their move away from the busy suburbs of Brighton, West Sussex, into the wonderful Herefordshire countryside. Still to come, we have the mystery house to unveil, which might be a perfect match for our couple.
This is exactly what we were thinking about when we were talking about moving. So, you know, something a bit unusual, something a bit different.
And I'll be finding out how small-scale drinks production is being brought to the masses with some age-old hard graft.
It's in the shake. Gosh, you need muscles, don't you? It's the start of our second day's house hunting here in Herefordshire, and one thing became clear yesterday. Our couple are prepared to compromise, particularly when it comes to outside space. Which is just as well, because the mystery house offers them all the space and character they're after in the heart of a village, but you don't need green fingers to live there. Our last property stop is again down south in Ewes Harold, right near the border of England and Wales. And before we get to the mystery house, I want to show Les and Ian all that's on offer in this pretty local village that serves it. Well, we're in the village of Ewes Harold, which is in southwest Herefordshire. It's a really popular village, not least because it's so pretty, but also because it's got just about everything you need, which is why I really wanted to show it to you. There's a fantastic butcher's. They cure their own bacon in there. You've got a village shop and post office that has everything you need in, and then some couple of really good pubs. There's also an amazing fish and chip shop.
That sounds good. Quite nice, thank
you. You ready to go and see the mystery house?
We are.
Come on then, follow me. Okay. Right this way. Because the mystery house is literally on your doorstep.
Oh, good heavens. Good grief.
That was a long walk.
Goodness.
All right. Wow.
So if you need your bacon from the butcher's, it's just over there. When you run out of anything else, the shop's there.
I love the look of it.
I do.
I think it looks great.
It's a detached stone property, dates back to the early 1800s, and it's a barn conversion.
Ah.
And the mystery isn't just the location here in the village. There isn't a garden with this property.
No garden at all?
No, nothing. That's your compromise. There's a tiny little courtyard garden, that's all.
OK.
Ooh.
Yeah.
I'm excited about this one.
I am very excited.
It looks great.
Can't wait to see it now.
Yeah, definitely.
Right in the heart of the community of this classic Herefordshire village, our early 19th century detached mystery property has great appeal and presence from the road. And I'm keen to find out whether our buyers will like what lies beyond. Formed from the conversion of two stone barns, it has double gables, an integral garage, and a robust wooden front door.
So we're straight into this fantastic, cosy kitchen dining space. You can really see the history of the barn, can't you?
It's
beautiful walls.
Wow, this is great.
Do you like it?
I do.
Very much.
Very much. Mm. This is exactly what you like as well, isn't it?
Yeah.
Excuse me, guys.
Sorry.
No.
It's just very nice.
Is it? Has it just got you somewhere?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, I'm fine, but it's just so lovely. It's really just what we're looking for, really, isn't it?
It is. This is exactly what we want.
I love the stone walls. And the beams and the thickness of the walls and the feel of it.
To a country thing, isn't it, coming in through the kitchen?
Yes.
Yes.
I like that.
It's great.
Yes. It's great.
This is lovely.
Well, we're off to a good start.
Definitely.
Yes, absolutely.
Let's carry on.
OK.
Well, if it's character and space you're after, how about this?
Oh, crikey, this is lovely.
Oh, my God, this is great.
This is really beautiful.
Like a minstrel's gallery.
Isn't it lovely?
Wow. This is fantastic.
It's really lovely.
It's so bright.
I was going to say how light it is.
Isn't it?
Love those windows.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
You can really see in here that it was two barns. You can see the high ceilings, all the detailing.
Yes.
It's all there, isn't it?
Yeah.
There's no tears from you, but you do seem quite emotional in your reaction to
it. Oh, yeah. I'll cry in private, don't worry.
Provoking high and hidden emotions, there's no doubt that the mystery property is having a positive impact. and the proportions are certainly impressive too. As well as the kitchen, breakfast room and large living room, the ground floor also features a study which is accessed via a dining room. This separate dining area could be a great space for formal occasions when hosting all the guests our couple plan on entertaining. The study behind it has original exposed brickwork and offers privacy and quiet. When it comes to storage solutions, there's also a utility room to hide away the white goods, as well as the large garage with double timber doors to the front.
This is exactly what we were thinking about when we were talking about moving. So, you know, something a bit unusual, something a bit different.
Yeah.
It's great.
And, you know, even the colours are just so lovely.
Yeah, it's bright. It's really bright.
What I haven't told you is that upstairs you've got plenty of space as well. You've got four bedrooms.
Oh, four bedrooms?
Upstairs, goodness. Yeah.
Wow.
So let's go and decide which one could be the master suite.
OK.
Upstairs, off a grand galleried landing, there are two bedrooms at the rear of the property. Then the other two have aspects to the front and include the largest double, as well as a smaller room currently used for craft and sewing. Then at the back, a third bedroom is presented as a dressing room, next to which is another pleasantly decorated double.
I'm bringing you into this one. It's not currently used as the master bedroom. It's not the largest, but I just think there's something really pretty about it.
It's really sweet, isn't it?
Yeah, it's very light.
It's very light. If you just take a look behind you, I love them.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yeah, the beams.
Yeah, it's beautiful. Yeah. There's a smaller bedroom being used as a dressing room right next door, and then you've got a shower room next door, so you've almost got your little self-contained suite here.
Yeah.
Yes.
There's the other bathroom for when you've got visitors that come to stay.
So. Right, right.
No, this is great.
This is a lovely room, isn't it?
Yeah.
And it's a good size.
But let's just go and explore one of the other bedrooms anyway, and then you can decide which one you fancy, because there's options with four. So everywhere you look up here is just another beautiful feature.
Yes. I love this, Les.
And this is the room currently used as the master bedroom.
Right.
It's got all the beautiful features, the original beams.
Yes, lovely.
It's a nice atmosphere.
Mm. Yeah, you're smiling?
I am.
Oh,
okay.
Both Ian and Les are quite clearly bowled over by everything within the chunky, historic walls of this striking mystery property. And this is normally the point where I would say, let's explore the garden outside, but there really isn't that much to consider. What we do have, however, is a pretty intimate and sunny south-facing courtyard.
So, here we are, straight out into a compact little courtyard. I did say there was the mystery, and this is the mystery.
It's very private, though. It feels very private.
It is, yeah, it is. And it's small. You know, we saw the small one yesterday as well, and we were prepared to compromise on that.
Yes.
So,
yes.
Yeah, I think we could live with that.
So how are you both feeling at this point, Les?
I'm feeling fearful it's going to be out of our budget, but I'm hoping it won't be.
What do you think this is on the market for?
I think it's going to be very near the top of our budget. So I'm going to say 295.
Okay.
Okay. I'm going to say a very hopeful 285.
Ian, you're bang on. It's on the market for £295,000. Yes.
My goodness. Look at that, I got it right.
Well done.
But more importantly, it is within your budget.
Mm. Yeah.
How do you feel now?
That's great.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was convinced it'd be over.
I was too.
Definitely.
So, very excited.
That's fantastic. Mm.
Would you like to go and look around again?
I'd love to.
Well, I think we should.
Go on then, go and take your time.
Thank you.
Come and find me when you're ready. This is fantastic. They've gone from hoping for half an acre to being happy with a pretty little patio. Just shows the house is right, that's all that matters.
On the market for offers around £295,000, the mystery property is a detached stone barn conversion with roots in the early 1800s. As such, it's laden with historic gems and character. It comes with four bedrooms, a kitchen diner, and three reception rooms. And although limited on outdoor space, the property is very well connected for local amenities, being smack bang in the middle of a desirable village.
I'm very excited by this house, and it's certainly a very strong contender. I know we didn't ask for a dining room, Les, but This is a lovely room, isn't it?
Yeah, you would want to change it. It just lends itself to it, doesn't it?
It does. Can you imagine formal dinner parties in
here? Yeah, yeah. But the best thing is the study.
I know, isn't that just lovely?
That's just fantastic. We're definitely excited about this house. Yeah, there's no doubt about that. As I say, it really got us thinking from when we saw it first. So this is the kind of ideal house for us. So we're definitely going to give it some serious thought.
Big smiles.
Yes.
And lots for you to take in.
Absolutely.
Lots.
That's all the house has seen.
Okay.
Now it's time to do some thinking and then some talking.
Okay. Okay.
A defining characteristic of the Herefordshire landscape has to be its orchards. Once described as a forest of fruit trees, this region has a proud history of cider and perry production that dates back to the 17th century. Today, over a billion Herefordshire apples are needed to meet demand for the cider industry on a commercial level. But at the domestic end, many of our homegrown apples are wasted and left to rot. So local resident Deborah Davies has come up with a way of using up all the fruits you may have cultivated in your back garden. I've come to her home in the village of Putley to find out more.
Hi, Deborah.
Hello, Ginny. Nice to meet you.
It's good to meet you too. Now, I brought you some apples. My apple tree at home has had so many this year, and I've run out of ideas for what to do with them.
Excellent.
I think you might have a solution for me.
I do. Lots of people have one or two trees in their garden, and the same thing as you explain, they just fall on the ground and rot. So what we have set up is a little pressing service for small volumes of fruit where we can turn your apples into cider and apple juice.
On their own, my batch isn't enough to make a sufficient pressing. So we're going to pick a few more from Deborah's orchard to bulk up my basket.
So how are we looking, Deborah?
I think we have enough apples here. Let's get them over to the press.
Lovely.
The prime motivation for starting the press was to encourage locals to safeguard the original Herefordshire species, now mostly found in residential gardens. The feeling being that by helping people to maximise the yield of the apple crop, the more likely they'll be to tend, prune and graft their trees, which should in turn preserve them for the future and so protect the heritage varieties. Deborah's partner Nigel is already sorting and cleaning apples for the next pressing batch.
What, mix all the different
mix
varieties
all in? Yes.
OK, so that's unusual. I would have thought that you'd have used one variety of apple to produce cider from, but that's not the case.
It makes a much more full-rounded juice and cider if you use different varieties.
It takes about 50 kilos to make 25 litres of juice.
OK, so the apples are washed, they're ready to go. How many buckets of these are we going to need?
Probably another 5 or 10. We've done a few already.
Well, let's do this one. Fill this one up properly. Give it a shake. Gosh, you need muscles, don't you?
Next up, we slowly and steadily transfer the apples to the scratter, which mashes the fruit into a pulp.
The next stage is to shovel these scratted apples, the pulp, into the press. And we're then going to put a number of shovelfuls in each cloth, fold the cloths over to create cheeses.
OK.
Cheeses, as per cheese making, you squeeze the juice out of the cheese. It's the same principle with cider. You squeeze, make a cheese and squeeze the juice out of it.
With gloves on, we then place shovels of apple pulp into the cloth cheeses.
You can see it's coming through quickly already, isn't it?
Just from the weight of the fruit.
The cheeses are stacked neatly on top of each other and then they're topped with a heavy, sturdy block, which will evenly distribute the weight across the press.
Would you like to come up and have a go on the press?
I'd love to.
Right, if you come in here where I am, right. Now you just simply pull the handle towards you. OK, now lift very gently and push back and watch the peg drop into the next hole and pull again.
How do you know when it's done?
Because you can't squeeze it any further. We've got a long way to go yet.
OK.
Once all the juice has been extracted, the pulp scraps are given to a local farmer who feeds it to his rare breed pigs. And that leaves the fresh apple liquid, which is bottled and left to ferment for 6 months before it becomes cider. But I can't wait that long. And after all that work, I've definitely built up a thirst, so Deborah has a glass for me to sample.
Well, that's not what I was expecting at all. It's not as sweet as a lot of the commercial varieties. That's what I like about it. Tastes really like apples.
All of the sugar will be fermented to alcohol, so it's completely dry, but it is bottle conditioned So we've got a little bit of yeast giving it a fizz.
That's it. It's got to wait 6 months to try mine.
You do.
Can't wait.
What a treat on a sunny autumn day to make and taste the local nectar in a county where fruit production is woven into the fabric of its economy and culture.
Two properties have really struck a chord with Les and Ian. Now they've had time to reflect, I wonder if they'll still feel the same about them. Hello, you two.
Hello, Jenny.
Well, sadly, the end of our house hunt here in Herefordshire. And I think that two properties have stood out for the two of you. Would that be fair to say?
I think that's very fair to say, yes.
So come and talk me through them.
Well, the Edwardian house we saw, we really liked that. We had to compromise in the garden, obviously. But the house itself really fulfilled everything we were looking for, didn't it?
Yes, had lovely, spacious rooms, plenty of them. So yeah, we did like that.
And then there was the mystery house. Which?
And then the mystery house.
The mystery house, well, it was a mystery. A real surprise, actually.
Yeah.
Lovely village, lovely location. And we're taken aback with the size of the house when we walked into it. I really loved the rooms, lots of original features.
I really liked it, it was great. It gave us more than we'd asked for again. Again, we had to compromise in the garden, but that wouldn't be the end of the world for us.
So is there a what next with either of those two properties?
I think the one that stands out really is the mystery house, to be honest with you.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. So that would probably be more likely one we would see again.
Mm.
That had a really strong reaction, particularly with you, Ian. And actually, Les, actually, you commented as well on how atmospheric
it felt. It just struck you the minute you walked in. Yeah, it was great.
And there was a great warmth about it, not just because the heating was on, but there was a genuine warmth within the building. It was a much-loved house, that was what came across.
Yeah, definitely, yeah. And beautifully furnished, beautifully decorated. So, yeah, that's more likely.
So would you say, after our house hunting here in Herefordshire, that you're drawn more to remote country properties or properties that are a bit closer to a village, a bit more in the thick of it all?
I think it's more in the villages, isn't it? I mean, we like to have facilities quite nearby.
Well, I love Herefordshire. I think it's a beautiful county and I can completely see the two of you making it home. I hope it's in the mystery house, but wherever it is, be very happy here.
Thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Jenny.
It's the end of our house search here in Herefordshire, and it's wonderful that Les and Ian have found two properties that they can imagine living in. Now, whilst they definitely do want to be rural, I think our search has shown them that they also want to be in the heart of a village, and the mystery house in particular would give them that. With the second viewing on the cards, I hope we've helped them find their home together in this beautiful county. Join me next time on Escape to the Country. Well, after that second viewing at the Mystery House, I'm delighted to report that Les and Ian were still enamoured with the property. So much so, they put in an offer which was accepted. And they're now enjoying life living in Herefordshire in that beautiful historic home. If you would like to escape to the country in England, Northern Ireland, Scotland or Wales and need our help, please apply online at bbc.co.uk/beonashow.